My name is Becky Brandt, I'm digital architect at the Digital Hub here in Ireland, and I'm going to be presenting with my colleague Marta, who works with Trinity, and talking about the process that we went through to prepare the repository for ingesting and publishing Orphan works after the European legislation came in 2012. So the DRI is a trusted digital repository for Irish humanities and social science data. We were funded by the Higher Education Authority in Ireland in 2012 to develop the repository, and we launched in 2015. So the basic idea is that it's a central internet access point for cultural heritage and social science collections in Ireland. So it provides an access point, but also in the back end is digital preservation services. And if you want to visit the repository, the URL is there. So these are some of our stakeholder organizations. You can see there's archives, libraries, museums, national broadcaster, universities, research centers. So the types of data that we would be ingesting would be things like qualitative data mainly, so images, text documents, and also digitized material, so physical cultural heritage has been digitized. And then we also have things like moving image and audio, so there's a really diverse range of data products that are available to the repository. And I guess what's important to note is that when we think about the type of material that's accessible in the repository, none of it comes from us. We provide the repository infrastructure, but we don't own any of the content that's published. And so I didn't want to go too far into my presentation without talking about what copyright is, because I know that not everyone is that familiar with it. And so basically, it's an area of intellectual property law that protects creative works, so that's things like literary works, artistic works, dramatic works, so all of the content that would be published in our repository would be covered by copyright legislation. And copyright is intrinsic, you don't need to register a creative work. Once you have a physical manifestation of your creative idea, it's automatically covered by copyright. And in general, copyright would last until 70 years after the death of the author of the creation. So what this means for the repository is that when we're thinking about things that are in copyright, there might be physical assets that were in copyright and then digitized, there might be more digital assets that are created and are covered by copyright. If you digitize a physical object and a new copyright covering the digital asset, and then if you have descriptive metadata that's describing the asset in the repository, that can also have its own copyright. So really, when we think about copyright in our repository, pretty much everything is going to be copyrighted. So in 2012, there was an EU directive covering publication of orphan works by cultural heritage institutions. And what an orphan work is, it's a work that is in a collection, and the collection owner knows that this is almost certainly covered by copyright, so probably something from the 20th century, but they are not able to either identify the copyright holder, or if they do know who the copyright holder is, they're not able to find them to ask for permission to digitize it. So with the Orphan Works Directive in 2012, there were new kind of regulations and workflows suggested that would allow cultural heritage institutions to do something with these works in their collection. So previously, if you knew you had a work that you couldn't identify the copyright holder, it was basically nothing you could legally do with it. So that didn't stop people publishing anyway. But now there's a workflow that allows you to basically perform a diligent search. So you basically have to go through the process of looking for the copyright holder and have proof that you've done that, and then you can register that work as one and publish it. So the directive was published in 2012 by the European Commission, and then member states had until October 2014 to enact it in national legislation. So our project kicked off in 2012, or 2011 too, and from 2012 we knew that this Orphan Works Directive was going to affect us, and that probably our colleagues would want to be able to follow Orphan Works with us, but we didn't know exactly how that was going to be implemented in Ireland, because in Ireland they did it in 2014 to enact the legislation. So as we developed the repository, we knew that we were developing a user interface that would allow people to ingest and publish, and we weren't yet allowing people to ingest Orphan Works. So that's a screenshot of the user interface for ingestion as it was at the time. So you can see we have a text box for a write statement, and that's mandatory for all assets in the repository, but it's free text, so we'd ask you to give us some information but we don't tell you what information should be given, so that should be very right. And then we would also allow people to have a license, so for all of the Creative Commons licenses, all of the database licenses, if you would like to license your assets. But we can also allow people to say they don't want to license those things, or all of the licenses. So at that time, people would show the information on the rights and license, but there was no way to know that the city was going to work. And it's also important to note that in the repository, once people have signed up with us as a depositor and they signed user agreements, there's no workflow whereby we check the information they give us. So they sign and say that they're taking on responsibility, that they're aware of what the right situation is, and they're happy to take on responsibility for publishing that asset. But it doesn't fully mean that you're not liable in the case of something like that, and the copyright actually contact with the publishers. So I'm going to pass over to Martin Sia. She's going to talk about a case study where she went through the process of registering what was there.
Okay, so this project was a demonstration project for the Digital University of Ireland, and we were digitizing the archive of the most famous stained glass firm in Ireland, the Halifax stained glass firm. And we had their entire archive, and as you can see there, the archive consists of all sorts of things, including designs for stained glass windows, photographs, order books, letter books, letter folders, financial information, you name it. So we had the permissions from the family to reproduce anything that came from the firm. The problem is that as part of the archive, there are materials that are not just coming from the firm. So for instance, all the letters from customers to the archive would not be coming from the firm. The cover holders to be able to reproduce. So, mostly in terms of what kinds of working words we had letters, we had drawings, mostly from architectural firms that no longer existed, and we also had a lot of photographs. And so, for us, they were all inherently interesting, and we wanted to expose as many of them as possible. So the Orphan Word Directive in many ways came at the right time. Okay, so in terms of what works are covered by the Orphan Word Directive, there are literary works, audiovisual works, cinematographic works, phonographs, and then there's another category that can include things like letters. But crucially, it doesn't cover photographs. It doesn't cover visually created works. So our drawings are not covered, and our really interesting photographs are not covered yet. In some countries, like in the UK, they have implemented copyright Orphan Word Directives that do cover photographs, but that's not the case now. Okay, so the workflow as it stands now works like this. You submit a report of due diligence to your national copyright authority, in this case the Irish Patent Office. Because we were the first people to submit our forms to the European Commerce Database, when we first submitted our open work, there was no due diligence forms that the Irish Patent Office had available. But since then, we worked with them, and they now have a form that we can use. I don't know if you can see much of it, but basically I put it in there so that when you are at the end, you can see the kind of information that they require for a due diligence search. And for those of us who are doing this day in, day out, there's nothing extraordinary there. Basically, you have to say that you have consulted the relevant sources, online directories, etc. And that you have carried out the due diligence. So you submit this to your competent national authority, that's how the European workforce database terms that. And then you go online to the European Orphan Works database and you fill in the information. First of all, and very importantly, institutions must be registered as beneficiary organizations before you can submit work to the Orphan Works database. And then, as I was saying, each country has a completely national authority. Once you submit your work to the Orphan Works database, they will receive notification, they will review the Orphan Works that you have submitted, and make sure that they do have the reports, the due diligence reports in advance, and then approve. And when they approve them, you receive an email from the Orphan Works Observatory in Europe saying that your works have been forwarded, which is a kind of strange terminology, but basically they mean that they have been approved and that they are now submitted. Okay. Once you register as a beneficiary organization, then you have like a dashboard where you can register your work, see statistics about who's using your Orphan Works and how. And you can also either submit your Orphan Works as individual works to an online form, or if you have many, then there is the option of doing a bulk upload. And for that, you receive a template from the European Conservatory that has the main things that we need to fill in and guidance across the field. So far, nobody that I have talked to in the UK and Ireland have used the bulk upload yet, but this is pretty much early days because most people have only started using this since October 2014. So as I said, you can register works in 2 weeks. And this is what the database looks like. There are 4 steps. So the first one is you give detailed information about your Orphan work. The second step is if there are embedded or incorporated works, that needs to be important for film, for broadcast, where you may have film clips and there will be music, and there will be different things embedded that have separate copyrights. Then you go into the screen that tells you what the Orphan Works status is, and finally you explain what use you're going to be making of the Orphan work. So, in May this year, I did a very quick survey of organizations in the UK and Ireland who have used the Orphan Works database. And these are the kinds of things that they have to say. And mostly what they say is, it's pretty straightforward, it's quick, and it's not too burdensome. Considering that, of course, due diligence searches are quite burdensome anyway. But the actual Orphan Works database doesn't add too much to the burden. But, and there's always a but, there were some complaints. So, for instance, some of the people felt that the form was quite repetitive, so there should be a different way of designing it so that you didn't have to enter information twice. And also that the categories of Orphan Work were not clear, and that the form was a little bit vague, so that it might be the case that even if you have registered an Orphan Work, that whoever is looking for it might not be. As I say again, these are very early days, so there are teething problems. But for us, as librarians and archivists, there are some missed opportunities in this. And the main missed opportunity is that when you register the name of the white legal information for the single work on the online form, there is no guidance about whether you should be using name authorities like VIA, for instance, the Virtual International Authority File. And there is nowhere in the form where you can actually state what the buyer ID for that name then. So that can lead to a lot of duplication because there's very basically very, very light guidance on how you should format what you enter and what information you're giving. Confusingly, the bulk upload spreadsheet does have a field that's named right holder buyer ID. So we don't quite understand why that hasn't been included to the online form for registering single works. So again, missed opportunities, but I'm sure that as they receive feedback from users, these things will change. Going
to pass you over to my colleague Rebecca again, so she talks about what DRI has done for holders. Okay, so the EU legislation and the national legislation in Ireland is clear that if you want to publish an orphan work, you need to go through this process, you need to do your due diligence, it has to be registered in the EU Orphan Works database, and then as a national repository, we need to know what to do with that information. So we were asking people to do this. But then how do they prove to us that they've done it? Like, is there like a method in terms of like software UI or in terms of our policies that could ensure that it's actually being done? And given that people upload and we don't check the records, how can we make sure that people are doing this? And I should say that we are lucky enough to have a legal advisor in DRI, Dr. Albert Dowd, who is professor of law here at Trinity. And we couldn't have gone through the process without legal advice because copyright legislation is like it's a legal problem and you have to make sure that you're covering your responsibilities when you're addressing it. So actually a lot of what we did ended up relating to our legal agreements with the depositors. So we have two different agreements before someone can ingest. Firstly, they sign an organizational manager agreement that defines the terms of what they're agreeing to and tells them what we're going to do for them as a repository. And then when it comes to the point of ingestion, there's also a tick box to say that you understand the terms and conditions that you agree to. And so we ended up changing our both of those agreements to state that people, if they want to publish Orphan Works, have to have registered on this database. So here is a screenshot of our new rights statement. So basically, if you come to ingest, if you hover over the information, you'll see that you're agreeing that you also to include the information from the database if you're doing your own work. So we ask that people have that information in your free text rights here. I think we kind of started out thinking about this kind of technical solution to this. So our ideal, or what we thought might be the case, was that we would need a way through the repository to check that something had a corresponding record in the EU database. It actually turns out, firstly, that wasn't necessary from a legal perspective. So if people are agreeing that they've done it and signed an agreement saying that they have, so we don't actually need to be able to check technically that there is a record in the EU database. But luckily, that's the case because it's actually not possible because the EU database, well, it's not possible to do it easily because the EU database doesn't have an API and they also don't have persistent identifiers for the records. Which would make it really difficult for us to check the corresponding records if we give us the ID numbers. We do still ask for the ID numbers. And we also have to look at where we're going to put this information in our data model. So like we use standardized descriptive metadata schemas, so like formal, smart, and AD. And there is no place to put this information except for in the rights field, and that seems to be how people So just to conclude, I think the most important thing to say is that people see the Orphan Works Directive as something that's adding to their workload maybe, because due diligence actually takes a lot of time, and now you have this extra step of going to your national competent authority and then going to the EU database separately to register. But the purpose of the legislation is to allow you to do more than you could do previously, so it's a really good thing, and it's great and very supportive. Also, I think we found that when Marcia spoke to some of the people using the workflow in UK and Ireland, people are a bit confused by it. So it's not that it's extremely complex, but this is a relationship between the competent national authority, the EU, and then where you're publishing.
beneficiary organization, and you might have talked to understand all of that terminology before we start. Also, I think a big, not an issue, but at the moment it's a shame that there are no persistent identifiers or API in the EU database, and also the lack of control vocabulary, so it's just inevitable that people are going to be entering records more than once, or there's no disambiguation between creators in the database at the moment. And finally, we actually found, and I think this surprised us by the end, that it wasn't a technical solution that was necessary. It was more the legal solution, and then like there was some technical work to be done, but it was pretty straightforward. That's it, sorry, I rushed through the end.